Hello, hello, and welcome back to another Yale Alumni Live. We are very excited to have a special guest with us today coming from Chicago. She's going to be joining us any moment, and we have a very exciting thing to talk about today. It's part one of a part two, and here she comes. She'll be with us in just a moment, live from Chicago, Alyssa Rapp. Hello, Alyssa.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, I'm so excited to be here with you today. So I got my background up and we're ready to go. So we're excited to, we're going to be doing this together two times this week, which I'm very excited about. So for those of you watching, this is part one of a two-part series with Yale Alumni Live. So we're going to get started and I'm going to let Alyssa tell you a little bit about herself and we're going to get started with her Yale experience. So Alyssa, if you would, just tell us about where you came from to Yale and the kinds of things that you were involved in at Yale.
So I grew up in Chicago in a suburb called Winnetka, Newshire High School, and went to Yale in 1996 with five of my high school classmates, which was a pretty high year.
Yeah.
Davenport College, and loved my 4 years. I was a member of Yale Dancers, so danced a ton. Double majored in the history of art and political science. My greatest accomplishment academically to date is I got the Frank M. Patterson Prize from the Poli Sci Department for the best senior essay on the American political system. So I have that plaque is probably my most prized possession as accolades go. And I have been a proud employer of a dozen or more at this point Yale summer interns. I helped start the Yale Bulldogs on the Bay summer internship program and have always had a Yale year or two working with me. So it's a lot of Yale pride. And I just co-chaired our 20th Yale reunion, which was virtual, which was quite a feat, but we got it done.
Yeah, well, that's, I mean, reunions this year, the poor classes that had reunions this year, feel so bad for you guys. But hopefully we'll be able to see you in person very soon. Sure. I'm glad that you were able to have a virtual reunion. So tell us a little bit about your life after Yale and your career path that you took, because I know you've been involved in a few different things post-college.
Sure. So right out of Yale, I worked for Hillary Clinton's first Senate race back in the day. It was the most seemingly interesting political race of the time. Man, how the world has changed. But I then went from her Senate race in the summer out of college to the finance director role for Congressman Dan Schakowsky. And I stayed in that role for 2.5 years and then decided to spread my wings and fly to business school at Stanford, where I ended up meeting my husband, who was also a Chicagoan displaced to the West Coast. And he was a classmate of mine, Hal Morris. And we ended up staying in Silicon Valley for about 14 years, ended up having two girls out there. I started a company called Bottle Notes, where I had a bunch of Yaleys work with me throughout a good 10-year run as an econ. Co-founded it with a Yaley as well, Kim Donaldson. And it was a 10-year run e-commerce company that pivoted to a media company. And then in 2015, when we exited that, I ended up taking a couple of years with when our second daughter was born, Henriette, to work with two family offices and two private equity funds doing advisory work and started teaching at Stanford Business School. And after a couple, 2.5 years of that, then rising kindergartner, now as of today, third grader, amazingly, Audrey, and Henriette and Hal and I moved back to Chicago in the summer of 2017, where both our families are from after his father had passed away unexpectedly. So we are here, loving the opportunity to be near two grandmothers and one father, and we are also having a wonderful time being back in the Midwest in general. Once we moved back, Hal stayed with the fund he works with in San Francisco, but I ended up joining the helm of Surgical Solutions, a private equity-backed healthcare services company, and I've been the CEO of that for about 2.5 years now.
So one of the things I didn't say at the onset is because I want to give you an opportunity to talk about it specifically is that Alyssa has two different books, which is kind of what we're going to be talking about today, just a little bit, giving you a little teaser of what we're going to be talking about later in this week in much more detail. But I have the two books here. My screen, since we're a split screen, is kind of small, so you can't see them. So Alyssa has two books, Leadership and Life Hacks and Hacks for the New World. And I know that many of you watching and people who are going to watch this in the replay have heard this term a bunch of times, hacks for this and hacks for that. And so we're really excited to have Alyssa tell us a little bit about what inspired her to write these books. And then we'll give you a little taste of what's in the books after she talks about that part of things. So Alyssa, tell us a little bit about how you came to author these books.
So the first book, Hacks, came to be when Forbes Books publisher actually approached me They are doing a CEO series, and I'd written some articles for Forbes.com, one on the secret to work-life balance as an entrepreneur being athletics, and the other on how culture can be a competitive advantage. And those articles have done well. They reached out to me and said, would you be interested in writing a book? And when I did a day and a half of planning with the potential editor, who ended up being the editor, Bree Barton, who's still a dear friend, we ended up architecting a story that I thought was interesting and compelling, and did synthesize, you know, a decade and a half of learning insights. And I said to myself, if I could take anything I've learned as a dot-com CEO and a PE-backed CEO and a mom and a wife and an entrepreneur and executive and help any spare anyone school of hard knocks that I've learned, I'd be thrilled to do it. So that's how that book came to be. And it's really 2/3 leadership hacks and 1/3 life hacks. And that came out in October of last year, hit the Amazon leadership bestseller, you know, status in January. And it actually inspired me to start a course that I now teach for the University of Chicago Booth Business School on women as investors, executive directors, et cetera. And so that was inspiring and fun for me as well as an outgrowth of that. But the second book, Hacks for the New World, was really also, they were both organic, but that was even more organic. When COVID hit, and I was, like all of us, kind of struggling with how to manage and cope both professionally and personally, I had enough friends, colleagues, readers reach out to me and say, what's your hack for this? What's your hack for now? What's your hack for this era? And so one Saturday morning with a massive cup of tea, I decided to sit down and crank. And it's not a 45,000 word plus book like the big book, but it's a little 10,000 word companion edition. But it is 19 leadership and 19 life hacks for the COVID-19 era. So again, things that the trade that I've learned in terms of managing our company and our home life in this period. And if they can inspire or spare anyone some school of hard knocks learning, I'm delighted to do so. And the 19 life hacks for the COVID-19 era was a quick talk I gave at our 20th reunion, Yale reunion, about a month and a half ago, I think by now. And so I don't know what questions you'll ask me a few days from now, Stephanie, but I'm sure it'll be something similar.
Well, I mean, I think about it every day, you know, how people are managing, especially moms. I know you talk in great detail about how moms can handle work-life balance, but I just think it's so impressive that in such a short period of time, you were able to pivot and put out this list of hacks. And so could you tell us a little bit about like how you define a hack and how you kind of come to put those together?
Yeah. So in the big book, the original book, I actually have a whole word from the author where I define a hack as a workaround or a work through. And the reason I felt like I needed to define it is because I actually struggled with whether or not that should be the thesis of this whole book movement for myself. And yeah, a place where hack didn't have to be thought of as a dirty word of hacking someone's computer or bank account. But actually, if you think about what a hack is, it's just a way to shortcut something and to end run something. And that classic 80-20 rule or Occam's razor, any metaphor you want to use. And so I thought that hacks was a way, well, like it or leave it, hacks are what I was using every day of my life. Yeah. Way to just put some thoughts on paper around what is the answer to that question of how do you live a life with maximum impact and efficiency and hopefully thus satisfaction. And, you know, people have described it as the 6-hour work week meets Martha Stewart. I don't know if those are the case. I do not hope to end up in jail, although I admire where it is as an entrepreneur. I aspire not to go to jail, God willing. But that this whole notion of, you know, Tim Ferriss's of the 6-hour work week, this whole notion of maximization of time for providing space for your own mental well-being and physical well-being and all of that is a big piece of what I also subscribe to. So some of the hacks are as obvious as put your own oxygen mask on first, or said differently, in the COVID era, do one thing for yourself every day. And, you know, start new routines, build new habits. I know my COVID new routine and habit or hack has been to try to pick up a couple days of meditation a week, and so far so good. And my kick in the tail on that was using an app called Habit Share that a friend of mine recommended. So I had to be accountable and saying what my goal was and whether or not I was doing it. And those are, you know, that's one narrow example. But that's how I guess I would loosely define hacks.
So do you ever feel like when you use the term hack, or when hack is the word hack is thrown around, that there's some negative connotation other than what you already discussed? But do you ever feel like you're not doing anything to its full potential when you say that word, that term hack? Do you feel like you should be giving it more? Or is this more of a way to kind of pivot in a sense?
So one of the hacks is this idea of episodic versus daily balance. I think that answers your question, Stephanie. So in the notion of episodic balance, what I say is pretty contrary to what a lot of people have said, I think, on the topic of balance, at least from a working mom and wife perspective. Mm-hmm. I believe you can have it all, but not all at one time. So I really try to prioritize two stakeholders a day. I mean, totally seriously. It doesn't mean I can ignore my totally, but today was the first day of school that in a hybrid model where my kids are going live. So today is a day to be a CEO and to be a mom. And of course, like, I love my husband. I'll do anything for him early, you know, and late in the day I can. But at the end of the day, this is a day to prioritize those two roles in my life and to expect that I will do other roles and I will be able to find, satisfy other key stakeholders, boards I'm on, students I teach, you know, as a daughter, even a wife, et cetera, later in the week. And so over the, if you widen the aperture of time and you think about balance as something to be achieved over several days or a week or 2 weeks, it's much more achievable. So I think that in that sense, hacking time or refining one's view about balance means changing the definition of what it is. One thing I won't give up is doing one thing for myself every day, which for me is working out, because that's my, you know, that's my joyride slash sanity check, as probably always will be. But other people might be something else. It could be walking their dog. It could be writing in a journal. It could be spending time with a loved one. It could be staring at the ocean with a cup of coffee. I'm not here to suggest what your one thing should be, but doing one thing for myself every day where I really feel like I've taken care of me frees me up to kind of spend the next 23 hours, so to speak, being in service to others, which is the goal in my life, at least. But it's, you know, that's, I don't think that, I think that those are hacks, not shortcuts. I don't believe in shortcuts. I believe in, and that's a nuanced difference, but, you know, 80-20, right? Don't let perfection be the progress is another hack from, you know, their book. I don't think that, even though I believe in perfect punctuation and perfect grammar and all the things I learned in high school and at Yale, I also know that, you know, if I have a great team of Yaleys working with me, I can't necessarily I have to trust in the systems and the people and not try to micromanage and therefore do everyone's job for them, but do 80, you know, spot check, do 80% of the work and hope that the other 20% gets away there.
I love that. I love that you say prioritize two things or two people. I think that's very helpful. As a Libra, I deeply feel everything you're talking about balance. It is my life. It's something I think about all the time, whether I realize it or not. So those tips are great, and I love them. And I'm wondering, maybe, Alyssa, while we have a few more minutes, if there are two or three other hacks that you could share with us before we get into much greater detail, which for everybody watching, you can come back and see us on the Yale Alumni Facebook group or Zoom on Wednesday, September 3rd at 7 p.m., and you can get more information at alumni.yale.edu, and I'll repeat that again at the end, but I just wanted to make sure that everybody knows that we are going to be doing this in greater detail. So, Alyssa, if you have a couple quick tips that you can share with us now, I think that would be awesome.
My last two quick tips for today will be ones that are directly relevant to our lives because we just went back to school. And so as a parent, one thing we've done a ton of since COVID hit has been leveraging local field trips and using all current available art supplies. So we've taken it upon ourselves to go to the beach, which is a mile and a half from our house, and pick up big rocks and come home and paint them. So this weekend, there was a lot of painting going on in our backyard. It was a beautiful weekend. The weather was great, which is not always the case in Chicago. But we've had a beautiful summer, thankfully. And there was a lot of ongoing painting of rocks for our virtual, for our physical rock, painted rock garden of the COVID era. And we also painted a bunch of Amazon boxes and made a make-believe tree. Them. Even had an interior designer friend, Annie Little, give us advice to create white trim on our make-believe treehouse on Amazon boxes, which was excellent. The power of social. So leveraging all current art supplies and DIY field trips has been one COVID hack. And a separate and different one has really been to create new workspaces for this COVID-19 era. So we did create new desks, not expensive, but new desks, new chairs, took existing Chromebooks or computers and created new workstations and decorated those workstations and made them be the place that when our kids go to school at home, which they now are doing for half the day, not full day, thank goodness, but when they do that, they are going to a place, a dedicated place. There's a psychological shift of this is where I do my work. In the same way that I come to a physical office to do that psychological shift to do my work. So those are two hacks, I think, for the COVID-19 era that will hopefully be helpful to some people out there.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for being here with us today. So this was just a quick little tip, a quick little insight into Alyssa Rapp. And for those of you watching, these are her two books. My camera's a little small right now with our background, but we will be back on Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, alumni.yale.edu, for how you can get online with us on Wednesday for Alyssa's much more in-depth look at these two books and life hacks to make things easier. So Alyssa, I will see you back on Wednesday. It's been a pleasure chatting with you, and I'm going to see if I can focus on two things in the next 2 days, and I will report back to you on Wednesday to see if I've had any success. Thanks so much, Alyssa. See you soon. Bye, everybody.